Welcome everyone to the latest in the spring 2016 STEM lecture series. I'm Don Barry, chair of the Physical Sciences Department. I coordinate the lecture series, and we're very pleased tonight to hear from a world famous volcanologist, Dr. Vic Camp, who's going to talk to us about the Yellowstone area. And I'm thinking we'll make the distinction between super volcanoes and super eruptions. I actually was on sabbatical last semester, and I went over to San Diego State and had a course from Vic. I'm very proud of the C- I earned. but as Vic will I'm sure get into, a lot of you are probably familiar with plate tectonic theory. Maybe some of you are. This notion that the Earth's outer shell, down to a depth of about 100 kilometers or so, is kind of broken up into these continent-sized slabs called plates. And that model has been in place since about the 1960s. Well, at about the same time that model came on the scene, another model was developed called the Hotspot or the Mantle Plume model. And so we'll hear a lot about the Mantle Plume model tonight and kind of implications for Yellowstone volcanism, which Dr. Camp studies. Dr. Camp once told me that his field area was, I think you said, the entire Pacific Northwest. And I know a lot of his research
wide area.
Is focused on the Columbia River basalts. So please give a warm welcome to Dr. Vic Camp.
Thank you. Thanks for the introduction, Don. Can you guys hear me okay in the back? Is it okay? Yes, no? Okay, great. So, you know, periodically you hear people talk about super volcanoes, super eruption, and often they give Yellowstone as a classic example of that. So it's really what I want to talk about. When we look at Yellowstone National Park, and this is where most of the discussion is focused, that's really part and parcel of a much larger magmatic system that began about 17 million years ago, all the way down in the Oregon-Nevada border region. So we can't just restrict the discussion to Yellowstone. These kind of eruptions, super eruptions, and Don's right, it's super eruption, not super volcano, and I'll explain that in a little bit. They're really on a scale that's far removed from human experience, a much grander scale. And that presents a bit of a problem because they haven't been documented by historic observation. So we'll talk a little bit about that and how geology can help us, you know, looking at past eruptions, how looking at the geology can help us understand what these eruptions are actually like. But before I do that, I want to talk about a few fundamental concepts just to sort of set the stage for the further discussion. Just beginning with a couple of simple definitions here. You know, when we use the term magma as opposed to lava, both these refer to molten rock. Magma, however, exists only beneath the surface of the Earth. And when it erupts as lava. There's actually a compositional difference as well, because when it erupts as lava, it actually degasses, you know, so it loses a lot of gas that actually drives the eruption itself. So when I use those terms, those are the way that they'll be used. When we think of eruptions, there's a great spectrum of different types of eruptions. Some eruptions are very calm and gentle. Other eruptions are highly explosive. And what the driving force for that is really the chemistry of the magma itself. So to simplify this, I want to look at magma or lava in two compositional types. One type would be a basalt type lava. You know, if you go to Hawaii, there's ongoing eruptions on the Big Island of Hawaii today, and what you'll see is very calm outpouring of basalt lava flows. Nobody dies. You can easily outwalk a basalt lava. But then you go to the other extreme, and you have highly explosive eruptions, and these are associated with a different compositionally different type of magma that we would call a rhyolite. You know, very highly explosive, where material is rising high into the atmosphere, 10, 20, 30, 40 kilometers in the high stratosphere. So there's a lot of force involved with these type of eruptions that we don't see in basalt eruptions. So actually, as it turns out, when we look at the Yellowstone magmatic system, we actually get both types of eruptions, you know, looking at past eruptions associated with this. Eruptions today, you know, volcanic activity we see today is largely a function of plate tectonics. If we look at plate tectonic boundaries, those are clear delineated areas of volcanic activity. You know, we live on a mobile planet. You know, we go back about 200 million years ago and all the land masses on Earth were combined into a supercontinent referred to as Pangaea. and that began to break apart, and then continents started to move about the globe. This goes back originally to Alfred Wegener's concept of continental drift. But in reality, it's not the continents that move. We know that today. It's tectonic plates that move. You know, the continents are just sitting on tectonic plates. Tectonic plates are the rigid outer portion of our planet, a layer that we refer to as the lithosphere. And the driving force of that mobility is in the mantle itself, and it's driven by internal heat within our planet derived from different sources. So if we have hot areas, this would be a cross-section of the Earth. If we have hot regions, that results in rocks that have a lower density, and those rocks can then start to rise up up towards the surface and then spread apart near the surface. As they move in one direction, they begin to cool down, they become denser, and then they descend back down into the mantle. And what that produces is a circular type of motion. And if we have a rigid plate that sits on top of this moving asthenosphere, then that will move along with the convective plate motion. So this is what drives all plates on Earth. At the boundaries of these so-called convection cells, here, for example, and here, both those boundaries are areas of very abundant volcanic activity. So, for example, just in a simple model here, where you can see two convecting cells, where the hot material rises up, this corresponds mostly with oceanic, mid-oceanic ridges. In the center of most of our oceans, we have a major source of volcanic activity associated with these ridges. The material moves up, and as it moves up, it melts. And the reason it melts is not because we add heat, it's because we lower the pressure. We keep the heat constant, lower the pressure, and that causes melting. And then when these rigid plates of lithosphere move apart, then the melt erupts on the surface of the Earth at mid-oceanic ridges. And the composition of that melt is basalt. So it's underwater, it's non-explosive, but we actually create seafloor in this fashion. The entire seafloor in our planet, everywhere, you know, is created here, you know, right at the mid-oceanic ridge. And then when the plates move away, again, driven by this convective type motion, when it moves away in this direction, when we get to this edge of the cell, the lithospheric plate then descends down into the mantle. And this usually occurs at the deep ocean trenches that you see over here and over here. And as it descends down, we get another area of active melting. And that melt, because it's mobile, has a lower density, rises up to the surface, and can erupt at the surface as a series of island arcs if it occurs on oceanic crust, or if it occurs on the continent, it can produce a linear belt of volcanoes that will parallel the oceanic trench that exists here. So at this spreading area, major volcanism, at this area, the process is called subduction, where the plate descends down. That's another area of abundant volcanic activity on Earth. So the plate boundaries, you know, that are coincident with the mid-oceanic ridge and the oceanic trench, those plate boundaries are major areas of volcanic activity on our planet. But we also have, I just threw this in here, I forgot about this, but this is just to show you an interesting aspect of the volcanism that occurs at mid-oceanic ridges. Here we have a mid-oceanic ridge in the Atlantic, the mid-oceanic ridge in the Pacific is over here. This is called the Mid-Atlantic Ridge, this is the East Pacific Rise. And it's a funny looking map of the world because it highlights the oceans. You know, most all our maps highlight the continents. But what this is color coded for is age. And what you'll see is that the oldest the youngest oceanic crust always exists very near the center of the mid-oceanic ridges. And then the rocks get older and older and older as you go away from those mid-oceanic ridges. So in the Atlantic, the oldest crust that we have in the Atlantic Ocean is here on the eastern seaboard of North America, and also on the western seaboard of Africa. And the oldest oceanic crust we have in the Pacific is over here just off of the coast of Japan and the Marianas Islands. And this is consistent with that model of crust always being produced at the mid-oceanic ridge, but then moving away, getting older and older and older. So the oldest crust is over here. But because of that model of oceanic crust always being produced at the mid-oceanic ridges, and gobbled up at the oceanic trenches, it's constantly recycled. And this covers 70% of our planet, but nowhere on Earth do we have oceanic crust that's older than 200 million years, which is incredible because the Earth is 4.5 billion years old. So it's very, very young oceanic crust because of this constant recycling. At the oceanic trenches where it melts, again, I mentioned that this process is what we refer to as subduction, and there are many examples of this, but particularly in the Pacific Ocean, this is something we refer to as the Ring of Fire. Many of you may have heard that term before. All along the rim of the Pacific, from the tip of Chile all the way up through Central America, there's a gap in here. Here in the Pacific Northwest is a major part of the Ring of Fire. The Aleutian Island Arc System, Kamchatka, the Japan, the Marianas Islands, these are all associated with subduction, you know, with oceanic plate descending down into the mantle. The Atlantic is different. There's only two really small trenches here in the Atlantic, one here in the Caribbean and the other one down here in the South Sandwich Island. But most of this volcanism rims the entire Pacific Ocean, the Ring of Fire, very, very active, the most active area of volcanic activity on Earth. One thing that's important for us, of course, here in the Pacific Northwest is that we also have a subduction zone that exists off of the coast of Northern California, Oregon, and Washington. And the result of that subduction, as you can see here, as this plate called the Juan de Fuca plate right through here, this is the oceanic trench, as it moves in this direction, subducts down, as you can see here, and melts, we have a whole series of active volcanoes that exist in the Cascade Range. These are the type of volcanoes that can erupt in a highly explosive fashion, like Mount St. Helens did in 1980. Very, very active volcanism. Here you can see Mount Hood, for example, Mount St. Helens, Mount Rainier. If we look at this in the whole perspective, in California, we have three of these active volcanoes, Lassen Peak, Mount Shasta, Medicine Lake Volcano. But there are 15 active volcanoes in the Cascade Chain, going all the way up into Canada, into British Columbia. Every single one of those volcanoes has in the past erupted and will in the future erupt, all of them. And all of them have the capability of producing a Mount St. Helens type event, very explosive type of volcanism. So this is a concern here in the Pacific Northwest. Just kind of emphasize this, if you look at this, the lower axis here in this plot, this is time going back 4,000 years. And these icons, volcano icons, represent eruptions in the past. So you can see that many of these have been exceptionally active. For instance, Mount Shasta, we've had numerous eruptions out of Mount Shasta in the last 4,000 years. The most active is Mount St. Helens. Of course, this is the one that people remember erupting so explosively in 1980. These are the kind of eruptions that have come out of these subduction-like volcanoes. Mount St. Helens and the Cascade. If we go up to the Aleutian Island Arc System, this is a readout volcano in 1998 in the Aleutians. We go to Chile. We've had numerous eruptions in Chile and the Andes Mountains. This is a very recent one that occurred in 2011. One after another, you can see how explosive these eruptions are. There are other areas, however, of volcanic activity that are not associated with plate tectonics. So this is something we'd refer as intraplate or within-plate volcanism. And when we talk about Yellowstone, this is the kind of volcanism that we're discussing. It has nothing to do with a plate tectonic boundary, like most volcanic activity, but it occurs in something we often refer to as a hotspot. And you can see many hotspots, all these individual dots, red dots that you see here in the oceans, and some on the continents represent hotspots. And these are also associated with linear belts of older volcanic activity that we refer to as hotspot tracks. You can see one here, a classic one associated with Hawaii. And Yellowstone is on this map right here, and a little hotspot track that you see associated with it that goes down through southern Idaho, and we'll talk a little bit about that. Hotspots are not only associated with hotspot tracks, but they're also associated with the vast outpouring of basalt lava, much of which occurs underwater, much more volcanism there than what we see at a mid-oceanic ridge. I mean, the oceanic crust becomes much, much thicker. So these underwater oceanic plateaus, you know, are scattered here in the, you know, in all oceans, we can see them. But we also have the eruption of vast volumes of basalt associated with these hotspots that occur on continents. And these are what we call continental flood basalt provinces. Some of these are associated with great mass extinction events on Earth, like the Siberian flood basalt, as associated with the Permian mass extinction event in time. It's contemporaneous with that mass extinction. The Deccan flood basalts in India are contemporaneous with the extinction that killed the dinosaurs that many of you know the story of the impact, you know, the meteorite impact. Well, at the same time, we have this vast outpouring of basalt lava in India. But the other thing that I want to point out is we have a flood basalt province right here in the United States in the Pacific Northwest, the Columbia River flood basalt province. This is the youngest flood basalt province on Earth. And the age of that event is 16.7 is when it began, a million years ago. You'll remember, when we go back, that we have Yellowstone that's not too far with a hotspot track associated with it. And immediately to the right of that, we also have the Columbia River flood basalt province. Those two are connected genetically. So we'll talk a little bit about that. But just to explain these hotspots, this is a little bit controversial. In fact, Don, where Don goes? He's out there somewhere. As Don was talking in the introduction, he said, you know, there's this controversy about mantle plumes. It's turned into a bit of a controversy, you know, whether or not mantle plumes exist or not. But the whole concept of a mantle plume is that many people believe that they're what caused the volcanism associated with hotspot activity. And the concept is that these are derived well down into the near the core of the Earth, right by the core mantle boundary where it's very hot. And these are plumes of hot rock that can rise all the way through the entire mantle. And when they come upon the lithosphere of the Earth, you can see here and here, this is where they may melt, and then we'll produce basalt volcanism that occurs at the surface. So many people believe that these oceanic and continental hotspots are underlain by mantle plume activity. So here you'll see a plume rise in this fashion. Plumes are thought to be composed of two parts, a large bulbous head and a feeding plume tail. And the head sort of blows up like a balloon as it rises up because it's constantly being fed by hot rock from the tail. So more material is going into the head faster than the head can rise through the mantle. So it actually gets larger and larger. And then when it hits the base of the lithosphere, that's where it spreads out and begins to melt. And this is where we can produce oceanic plateaus and flood basalt provinces on the surface of the Earth. So that's the model. You know, that's what many people believe. And it fits a lot of the geology. For instance, if you look at Hawaii, you know, the common Hawaiian islands that we know are located right here. You know, these are the ones that we visit. But in reality, those small islands, there's eight or nine of them, are part and parcel of a much larger tract of ancient volcanoes, ancient seamounts, if you will, that goes all the way up to the Aleutian Island Arc system, all the way up here, about 3,000 feet. So this would be the hotspot tract associated with the Hawaiian islands that we see today. Now, you notice that hotspot track is parallel to the direction of the Pacific plate. So it's moving directly away from the mid-oceanic ridge, the East Pacific Rise here. So the whole plate's moving in that direction, parallel to the Hawaiian hotspot track. So if we look at the Hawaiian islands, you know, the common Hawaiian islands, and date the rocks, we can date rocks by the process of radiometric dating. What we see is the only area of activity today on Hawaii is on the Big Island, particularly on the southeast side of the Big Island, right here, near Kilauea. Mauna Loa volcano has also been recently active. So this is the only place we have active volcanism in all the Hawaiian islands. But if you go to the next island to the northwest at Maui, the age of the rocks here, about 1.3 million years. You go to Molokai, about 1.5. Oahu, about 3.5. Kauai, between about 5 and 7 million years. So we have a very consistent progression of older ages off to the northwest. And that progression is absolutely consistent with the seamounts that exist along the Hawaiian chain even further away. Here you can see the common Hawaiian islands, but as we date these underwater seamounts, they also get older and older. Once you get to the Midway Islands, here you can see the date at Midway. It's about 27 million years old. Continue all the way up to the Suico seamounts, about 65 million years. So this consistent trend is indeed consistent. And the whole idea here relating to a mantle plume is this. Plumes are independent of plate tectonics. So what many people believe is that they're stationary or near stationary. So what that means is if we have a stationary mantle plume and a plate that's constantly moving over it at a fairly rapid rate, you know, a few centimeters every year, so it's geologically very rapid, what will happen is we will produce a progressively older and older volcanoes as the plate moves away. So what this would mean, for example, it would mean that Oahu 3.5 million years ago was located here. right above the mantle plume with active volcanism in the ensuing 3.5 million years that moved over here, and then new volcanism began to produce a new island, which of course would be the Big Island of Hawaii. So that track of progressive ages is very consistent with a model like that. It's difficult, you know, nobody's actually come up with a more rational explanation of why those progressive ages exist. So that is a good introduction to what's happening at Yellowstone. Because we mentioned that there's a hotspot track associated with Yellowstone. There are very few places on Earth where you can demonstrate the same progression of ages that exist on a continent as they do in Hawaii and other hotspot tracks. If you look at Yellowstone, of course, this is Wyoming. Yellowstone National Park is right here. These are outlines of major rhyolite volcanic centers. And those rhyolite centers, if you look closely, you can see them here on this map. They have ages that progress from Yellowstone to the south southwest through this very flat area we call the Snake River Plain, you know, right through there. And if you look at the ages, the last large super eruption at Yellowstone was about 640,000 years ago. As you move farther away, about 5 million, 10 million, 12 million, you know, 12, 13, all the way over to here, where the oldest rhyolites in that hotspot track are at 16.5 million years. Now keep in mind, the oldest rocks in the Columbia River flood basalts are 16.7 million years. So essentially they began at the same time. So what we believe is a mantle plume arrived at that time and is responsible for producing the Columbia River flood basalt province as well as the Snake River Plain hotspot track. So this is the connection, you know, the physical connection. The very oldest basalts that exist in the Columbia River flood basalts are right here in southeast Oregon. So they're the ones that are 16.7 million years. Sitting directly on top of those are rhyolites that are 16.5 million years, derived from the oldest rhyolites on this continental hotspot track. So this, we believe, one model for this is that the flood basalts are a product of melting of the plume head, but the hotspot track is a product of the plate moving over the plume tail. So how would this work? Well, we think as the plumes rise, they come up to the lithosphere, which is very rigid. That's the tectonic plate, and that causes the plume to spread out in this fashion. And you can see it here. It hits a rigid lithosphere, and it spreads out in that way. At that point, volcanism begins at the hottest part of the plume, which is right here in the center of the mantle plume head. This is a model of what could happen here. Once the plume arrived, the plume head then spread out in this fashion, and we have these ages that are very consistent that show a progression, rapid progression of ages, off in different directions like this. So this would have been eruption of the flood basalt province. And then as the plate, if you see the direction of the plate motion is just like this. The North American plate is moving in this direction parallel to the hotspot track. So what we believe happened is the head was sheared off, and that then allowed the plume tail to produce a hotspot track right here, consistent with what we see in Hawaii, you know, progression of ages all the way up to Yellowstone National Park. So what I want to just look at is that the very first slide I mentioned that we have both basalt eruptions that are very gentle, and we have rhyolite eruptions that are highly explosive. If we look at the Columbia River flood basalts, these are all basalts. You know, we would consider those relatively gentle eruptions. But they're quite different than any kind of basalt eruption we have on Earth today, like Hawaii. You know, Hawaii is the most active basalt eruptions that we have on Earth, and it has been for quite some time. But the size of these flood basalts are enormous. You know, the entire Columbia River flood basalt province erupted about 210 cubic kilometers of basalt over, geologically, a very short period of time. And they don't erupt from volcanoes. They erupt from fissures in the ground. And then magma comes up those fissures, as you can see right here, and erupts as a linear system of lava that literally pours great volumes out on the surface of the Earth. When that eruption ceases, the magma that exists in the cracks then hardens. And we see these today as these dikes. So, for instance, this would be sitting underneath this, you know, once it cools and solidifies into a hard rock. We've been able to map out these dikes in the Columbia River basalt, and there's three major dike swarms, the Steens dike swarm, the Monument dike swarm, and the massive Cheese Joseph dike swarm that exists over here. And we've been able to correlate many of those dikes with individual basalts that have erupted as well. So what we see going through this flood basalt province has been a lot of work done by numerous people over a long period of time. And we dated a lot of these rocks radiometrically. And what we find is that most all the basalts erupted, about 95%, erupted over a very short period of time, what we call the main eruptive phase right here. And that goes from, that should be 16.7, from 16.7 to about 15.6 million years. In 1 million years. Now, geologically, that's an incredibly rapid eruption of such a high volume of basalt, but it appears to be consistent with what we see in other flood basalt provinces as well. And we've mapped out groups of those basalt flows that are different chemically and mineralogically and otherwise to produce a stratigraphy here of different units. The main phase of the eruption are Steens and Naha, Grand Ronde basalt. These other two types are not as important, but sitting on top of that are Wannon basalt and Saddle Mountains basalt. The time interval between individual eruptions of these later basalts is much greater. Now, I want to stress these aren't individual flows, they're groups of flows. The Grand Ronde basalt probably has about 300 lava flows, massive basalt lava flows associated with them. This is a spectacular area, the flood basalt province. Luckily for us, this is also canyon land. You know, major canyons exist in northeast Oregon and southeastern Washington near the Chief Joseph Dykes Farm that exposes this incredible stratigraphy. Everything you're looking at here is a lava flow, you know, one on top of another, just a pancake stratigraphy of basalt lavas. And this bench that you see here, that bench actually represents the contact between a Naha basalt and Grand Ronde basalt right through here. So, you know, there's a physical boundary we can actually see here in the stratigraphy. This is in Naha Canyon in northeastern Oregon for people that might know that area. This is Grand Ronde Canyon, also in northeast Oregon, here and here. This is a Joseph Creek in northeast Canyon. So spectacular, beautiful canyon land and beautiful exposures of basalt. One after another, after another, after another. Individual flows, I mean, just take one of those flows. One of those flows does not pinch out. You know, we can trace these flows all the way from Idaho on one side to the Pacific Ocean on the other side. You know, they are major flows that travel great distances as single individual basalt units. Here are some in the Snake River Canyon, for example. Again, the contact between Naha basalt here and Grand Ronde basalt over here. When I was younger and more vital, we used to actually walk up these things and collect rocks, you know. Yeah, can't do it anymore. But that's what it required, actually. You know, we had to sample every single one of these flows, create a section, then you go to another section, do one after another, then you correlate between those sections. So it was a lot of work by an awful lot of people over a long period of time. So the thing I want to point out about these lava flows is when you get up to them and look at them and have an appreciation of the size of individual lava flows. You know, to emphasize this, I'll just blow this one up a little bit. So there's some people for scale. So this is a single lava flow. That's the top of the lava flow. This is the bottom lava flow. It's about 50 meters high. Imagine that as liquid lava. How do you do that? How does something like that flow on the surface of the Earth? You know, the emplacement of these things is a controversial issue. You know, how do you create a lava flow that travels from Idaho to the Pacific Ocean that maintains, you know, a tremendous thickness like this? So it's something we've never seen on Earth anywhere today, but we know it occurred in the past. So what we can do is look at some of these lava flows, just a very few of them. You know, this is a distribution of some of them. These are some of the flows we see in Wannon basalt, you know, just to show you some of the distribution. This is Idaho, Washington, Oregon. You know, so some of these are truly not only thick, but also very extensive. This is one of those lava flows in the Wannon basalt. Now, the reason I put here, this is fairly typical, and this is the fissure system that flow that erupted from. This is the Rosa flow. It says Rosalia, but it's actually the Rosa flow. And comparing the volume of this lava to the largest eruptions that we've had on Earth in historic time, basalt eruptions, There's an eruption that began in Hawaii in 1983. Many of you may be aware of this. It's on the Kilauea volcano in Hawaii. It's still going on. You know, a constant outpouring of basalt lava. Thus far on Earth, it has generated 1 cubic kilometer of basalt. You know, over 30 years it's taken to do that. And this is the, you know, the aerial extent of the Pu'o'o eruption. The largest eruption we've had on Earth of basalt in historic times occurred in Iceland. And this is the Laki eruption. The Laki eruption here, compared to Pu'o'o, that generated 15 cubic kilometers of basalt, the greatest eruption of basalt on Earth in historic times. The volume of one of these lava flows here, the Rosa flow, is 1,900 cubic kilometers, compared to 15 cubic kilometers. So again, just trying to emphasize the enormous size of these individual lava flows. And not just one lava flow in the flood basalt province. You know, we believe there's about 350 of these lava flows that make up the province as a whole. So the last group of flows, called the Saddle Mountain flows, these are kind of interesting because there's large time gaps that exist between individual Saddle Mountain flows. And because of that, it was enough time for erosion to take place so that many of these flows actually flow down ancient canyons. You know, if you look at the Pomona flow, for example, right here, it erupted in Idaho. It flowed down the ancestral canyon of the Clearwater River, and then the ancestral canyon of the Snake River, and then it spread out in a huge lava lake in central Washington, and then it spilled over into the ancestral canyon of the Columbia River, made it all the way to the Pacific Ocean, burrowed under sediments for 100 miles out into the Pacific Ocean. You know, so incredible history for that one single flow. And if you look at those flows, you know, they look quite different because we get good canyon exposures. You can see the ancient canyon here that was then filled with the Pomona flow in this case. And you can see another good example here. So that's the canyon wall that exists again with Pomona sitting on top of it there. So keep in mind that the beginning of those flood basalts are coincident with the beginning of the hotspot track about 16.5 million years ago. And these are those rhyolite centers that you see getting progressively older all the way up to Yellowstone, up through here. The model of that progression is the same that happens in Hawaii. You know, Hawaii is a very good example of the progressive ages, the same progressive ages we see here in Idaho. So using that model, that would tell us that we believe that there was a mantle plume that existed here 17 million years ago. But as the plate has moved over that stationary plume, the plume today is located over here, you know, underneath Yellowstone National Park. So here are some of those progressive ages of individual rhyolite centers. Now, I use the term rhyolite centers, but here you see a different term called a caldera. And many people believe that these are actually calderas. The definition of a caldera, as you can see here, is a large collapsed depression produced when a volcano collapses into its own magma chamber. And we see many examples of this. You know, one classic example, how many people have been to Crater Lake, Oregon? And a few. Great. So if you go to Crater Lake, you know the story of Crater Lake. This is one of those cascade volcanoes. You know, we give it a name. It's not there today, but we call it Mount Mazama. We had a huge eruption here about 7,000 years ago out of Mount Mazama, where we vacated so much magma out of the chamber that fed the eruption that the weight of the volcano simply collapsed down into its own magma chamber. And the result of that has produced this depression here that we see as a caldera, which was then later filled with water. If you go there today, this is what you find. You know, spectacular, beautiful, scenic caldera. And that caldera has a diameter. It's a little bit oblong, but you know, the average diameter is about 6 kilometers. So about 3.5 miles in diameter. And based on that, we can do something interesting. We can take the old flanks of the volcano, which are still preserved over here, and project that up into the air in a classic volcano shape, the kind of volcano that would produce this. And we can then estimate the height of Mount Mazama, and we estimate that about 14,000 feet, about the same as Mount Rainier, which is the largest of the volcanoes in the Cascade Chain today. Now, the reason I mention that is because many people believe that those rhyolite centers are calderas. But the problem is the size of those calderas. These aren't 5 kilometer calderas. You know, these calderas vary anywhere from about 30 to 100 kilometers in diameter. You know, so they're much larger features. When we have super eruptions, they're associated with these calderas, giant calderas, not regular calderas. So if we look at these calderas, You know, this term supervolcano that's come into being, there is no volcano. There's no volcano associated with these super eruptions. There can't be. Because if you do the same exercise, if you assume, for instance, that you have a caldera here that's, say, 50 kilometers in diameter. That's about average for these super eruptions. 50 kilometers. If you do the same projection and project that into the air in a typical volcano shape, that volcano would have a height of about 100,000 feet. It's not possible. You know, you can't have a volcano on Earth that large. It'd be too heavy, you know, just push down into the crust. So it just can't be. So what this means is that these are calderas, but there never was a volcano to begin with. So they form it in a similar way, but there's no volcano associated with it. So what we believe actually happens is rhyolite magma, very explosive magma, comes up and ponds in these really large magma chambers. And then that pushes on the crust and cracks start to appear. And eventually what will happen to those cracks will simply collapse into that magma chamber in much the same way as it would at Crater Lake, but there was never a volcano there to begin with. So that's that model is interesting because it makes us think about the style of eruption. You know, if this is what actually happens, what's the eruption like? You know, one way we can think about this, a classic volcano eruption is a point source eruption, you know, out of the summit crater of the volcano going well up into the stratosphere like this. You know, we see this, in fact, many of the images that I showed you earlier look a lot like this. But if we don't have a volcano for a super eruption, is it going to look like that? No, it's not. It has to be something different. And what we believe is happening here is we don't have a point source to these eruptions. What we have are many sources along fractures that exist, ring fractures that exist in the area of collapse. You know, these are occurring along ring faults, if you will. So it's not associated with a single point, but there are many sites of eruption all along those fractures. So the style of eruption would be much broader. You know, they affect very broad areas, something like this, over vast areas. You know, this would be an artist's rendition. And, you know, to put this to scale, the ring fracture here would go all along like this and way over here, you know, something like that. So there are individual volcanoes that come up those ring fractures, you know, over a vast area. So the result of this is we're producing huge volumes of material because it's not restricted to a single point source type of eruption. Supervolcanoes on Earth are out of the realm of our experience. We used to believe that the youngest one that we know of on Earth occurred 74,000 years ago in India. This is the Toba eruption that you see right here. People more recently have also argued for another eruption in New Zealand that occurred 26,000 years ago as also being a super eruption. But it doesn't make a difference which one of these are the most recent. They're still prehistoric. You know, we have no direct experience on what these are like. So the only experience we can gain is through the geology. If you look at Toba, Toba exists on the island of Sumatra. Here's an oceanic trench, so that means that's a subduction zone. So all the volcanoes that exist here are subduction-related volcanoes. If you actually look at Sumatra, you can easily see this caldera associated with it. This is the rim of the caldera. These calderas have an interesting feature. Once they're produced, they produce a nice flat floor, but then they surge upward. You know, they're called resurgent calderas. And when they surge upward, you know, hundreds of thousands of years can go by with smaller volcanic eruptions on the floor of the caldera. So that uplift in the center is very common for these super eruption type of calderas. And you can see it here easily in Toba. Yellowstone National Park. Interesting, at Yellowstone, we've had three super eruptions in the last 2.1 million years. One produced a large caldera here. This is another one, about 1.3 million, and the youngest, about 640,000 years ago, produced this large caldera with a diameter about 80 kilometers at Yellowstone. So very, very active system, but it's part and parcel of all those calderas along the Snake River Plain hotspot track. When these super eruptions occur, they create a lot of broken fragments that we call pyroclastic material because they're so explosive they obliterate all the magma into small and large fragments. And those fragments of pyroclastic material can be deposited in two different ways. One is an ash fall deposit. So this is material that blows up in the atmosphere, eventually has to fall back down. And for Yellowstone, you can see the area that's been mapped of Yellowstone ash from that ash fall deposit. This is the super eruption that occurred 640,000 years ago. But another type of eruption is something we call an ash flow as opposed to an ash fall. And this is a material that doesn't go in the atmosphere and fall. Instead, it flows along the surface of the Earth as a massive feature of hot pyroclastic gases mixed with ash fragments. And for Yellowstone, for this very same eruption, what you see in yellow, this is the 640,000 year edge of the caldera. What you see in yellow is the pyroclastic flow associated with that last super eruption. So, you know, when we look at ash fall, you know, again, this material is simply rises in the stratosphere, eventually has to fall down. And pyroclastic flows, on the other hand, flow along the surface of the Earth. And this would be an example of massive deposits of pyroclastic or ash flow material. So we get these at all eruptions, but the volume is much greater in the super eruptions. If you go to Yellowstone, well, this is the Yellowstone right here. It's in the Grand Canyon of the park. This gives the name to the river, and the river in turn gives the name to the national park. So this is a pyroclastic flow, you know, associated with the Yellowstone area. So then the question becomes, you know, once we map out all this material from the super eruptions, does that give us any sort of information that we can use to estimate the explosive force of the eruption itself? What we'd refer to as the explosivity of the eruption itself. And indeed it does. We believe there's a direct relationship between the volume of material that erupts and the explosivity of the eruption. And that's an important relationship. Because what that means is if we determine the volume and compare it to historic examples, then we can get the relative size of magnitude of explosivity, you know, comparing historic eruptions to the explosivity of these super eruptions. So to do that, we need a baseline. And a classic baseline, a beautiful baseline, is Mount St. Helens. It's beautiful for a number of reasons. One, it was an explosive eruption. But the other reason that it's nice is because it erupted almost exactly 1 cubic kilometer of pyroclastic material. So that's perfect, right? That's our baseline. You know, we know that was an explosive eruption, and that explosive eruption generated that much pyroclastic material. We also know that the volume of the pyroclastic material that erupts is directly related to the explosivity of the eruption. So how then would Mount St. Helens be compared to the greatest volcanic eruption of the 20th century? Well, that was the Mount Pinatubo eruption in the Philippines in 1991, and that eruption generated about 10 cubic kilometers. So one could say, using that algorithm, that the Mount Pinatubo eruption was 10 times more explosive than the Mount St. Helens eruption. Again, you know, as a first approximation. The greatest eruptions on Earth in historic times, the two greatest eruptions were both in Indonesia, and many of you will recognize the names. These are the Krakatau eruption of 1883 and the Tambor eruption of 1815. The Krakatau eruption generated 20 cubic kilometers of pyroclastic material. The Tambor eruption generated 30 cubic kilometers of pyroclastic material. So again, one could argue that the greatest eruption in historic times was 30 times more explosive than the Mount St. Helens eruption in 1980. That's probably, you know, good for a first approximation. Another way to look at this, you know, you think about how explosive something is, but what is the overall effect, like the number of people that may die? You know, obviously, the more explosive it is, the potential for death is high. So if we look at it that way, the Krakatau eruption was responsible for the death of about 35,000 people. The Tambor eruption was responsible for the death of about 96,000 people. You know, these are major killers on our planet. I'm going to put one other up here that's not historic, but it's close, and that's the eruption of Mount Mazama that produced Crater Lake, Oregon. You know, that's a normal caldera. We've never actually seen a normal caldera eruption either in historic times. This is the youngest. And the volume of material there was about 40 cubic kilometers of pyroclastic material. So this gives us good data in historic eruptions. How then can we compare that to, let's say, the eruptions at Yellowstone National Park? Well, at Yellowstone, again, we've had three eruptions. The three most recent eruptions have occurred since 2.1 million years. And the youngest of those was 640,000 years ago. the amount of pyroclastic material that erupted from those three super-eruptions are here. One of these produced 100 cubic kilometers of pyroclastic material, the other 600 cubic kilometers, and the third 2,500 cubic kilometers of pyroclastic material. If our algorithm is correct as a first approximation, then that eruption has to be 2,500 times more explosive than the eruption of Mount St. Helens in 1980. Those kind of numbers are difficult. You know, it's difficult to wrap your mind. You know, what does that mean? What would that be like? You know, it's very difficult to understand that. But it also places a great importance on trying to understand these eruptions, because they're going to occur in the future. You know, we believe that they occur on Earth somewhere about once every 100,000 years. You know, just because we haven't experienced it doesn't mean it's not going to happen. You know, it will happen, you know, somewhere. Yellowstone in particular, because it has such a long history going back for 16.5 million years, you know, one after another along that hotspot track, we always concentrate on the super eruptions, but I want to stress that once we produce a large, giant, resurgent caldera, hundreds of thousands of years can go by where we have little eruptions on the caldera floor. So there's numerous little eruptions also associated with these hotspot tracks. So if we look at Yellowstone, we know the last big eruption was 640,000 years ago. Are we going to have another eruption? Quite likely. Is it going to be a super eruption? Well, that's what I want to talk about. The first thing to consider is, what evidence is there that Yellowstone is still volcanically active? It turns out there's a lot of evidence. You know, one bit is shown here. This is kind of a funny diagram. Many of you may not have seen something like this. It's sort of like topography. But instead, it's topography based on a hypothetical surface that we call the geoid. And the geoid is a surface based on mean sea level. And this is commonly used in geology. The problem with the Earth is it has an irregular surface, you know, so the topography gives the topography we see doesn't give a true meaning to what the topography would be if it were, you know, more circular type of planet. But this does. But don't worry about that. The important point about this is what we see is that using a geoid, we see a very large topographic anomaly in North America. And the center of that anomaly is located right at Yellowstone National Park. Everything dips down from that area, you know, in all directions. So many people would argue, and it affects the entire western portion of the U.S., many people would argue that that's a thermal anomaly. So it's thermally buoyant. There's something hot underneath that's causing the buoyancy of western North America. The other thing we can look at, other than that geoid anomaly, is we can measure the heat flow. You know, and when we measure heat flow in different areas, you know, there's a tremendous difference in the amount of heat that comes out of the rock. And what we find is that the hottest place on Earth occurs in this area that's red. This whole area that we have in southern Oregon, down into northern Nevada, and a little bit of northeastern California, and then all the way through the Snake River Plain hotspot to Yellowstone National Park, these are areas with abundant thermal activity. We have a lot of thermal hot springs. There's great geothermal potential in this area, very high heat flow, all emanating from a point here at Yellowstone and then off to the west. Again, indicating that this is a magmatic system that has affected a very wide area. And, of course, in today's environment, you know, we have very high precision instruments, satellites, so we can measure various things in real time. And what you're looking at here is called INSAR satellite data. What this measures is ground deformation as it's happening. It uses radar. And what you see here, this is the caldera rim of the 640,000-year-old caldera. And all these lines represent uplift that's occurred. Over a two-year period, and you can see it right here, the entire floor of that caldera rose about 2 feet, you know, about that much in a two-year period. That's quite a lot of rapid uplift. But as it turns out, the interesting thing about the caldera, and we've measured this, you know, for a long period of time, is it actually almost acts like an organism. You know, it kind of rises and falls, just like it's breathing, you know, rises and falls. And due to this activity, we also get a lot of earthquakes. If you look at this image here on the right-hand side, I know you can't read this too well, but these are years that began in 1973 all the way over here to 2010. And on the vertical axis, these are the number of earthquakes. Look at those numbers. I mean, here, for example, in 2085, at Yellowstone, we had over 3,500 earthquakes. So every year that passes, we have 1,000 or more earthquakes on average in this area. Very, very highly energetic earthquake system. And this is most likely associated with this sort of up and down activity and magma pushing up underneath the caldera floor, all indicating, you know, that there's a thermal and probably magmatic volcanic system that is still active. And of course, anybody that goes to Yellowstone, you know the geysers. I mean, this is another indication. You know, geysers are hot rock, but these the water here has actually been superheated at depth. It can't just reach boiling. It has to be superheated far beyond the boiling temperature because it's under great pressure of the rocks. And then periodically it'll, you know, erupt in this geyser activity. So this plumbing system of really hot water is underlain by very hot rock that, again, has to be associated with a magmatic system. Everything points to this still being an active area of volcanic activity. You know, so what is causing this, and why has it been around for 16.5 million years? Again, this goes back to this concept of a mantle plume. Is there a mantle plume underneath Yellowstone or not? The problem that geophysicists have had for a long period of time is trying to actually image something that we can't get to. There is a methodology to do this. It's called tomography, seismic tomography, where geophysicists will use seismic waves. As the waves travel through rocks of different character, they change character. The waves will change character. For instance, when they go through material that has a lower density, those waves will slow down. And then we can read those waves once they come up to the surface. So the analogy for this would be a CAT scan. You know, you go to the hospital, you get a CAT scan, you look at your private organs in your body, right? Well, we can look at the private organs in the body of the Earth in the same way by using earthquake waves. But we've still never been able, until very recently, been able to image something that looks like a mantle plume underneath Yellowstone. Now, I said until very recently, and this was always the controversy, and this is why people said, oh, there's no such thing as a mantle plume. But the recent activity shows that there is something there. I'm not going to talk about these models in any great detail, but they're based on different types of earthquake waves or seismic waves. If we look at this one in particular, what you're looking at is a cross-section. The colors relate to the density of the rock. The lowest density material is represented by these red to orangish colors. Low density is generally interpreted not as composition, but as temperature. So the higher the temperature, the lower the density. So what we believe we have is a high this is Yellowstone National Park right here, is a very high temperature conduit that moves all the way down to the mantle as far as about 1,000 kilometers beneath the surface of the Earth. And that gives a hallmark appearance of a mantle plume. So there have been many papers written on this. Some people disagree, but most agree, you know, that the data is very consistent with a mantle plume model underneath Yellowstone. So if you look at Yellowstone, I mean, here's the park in the northwest corner of Washington. So this, I mean, Washington, Wyoming, one of those W states. Here's Idaho. This is Montana. So that's the caldera. We know that there's a magma chamber here and another magma chamber right there that's feeding small eruptions there in the caldera today, periodically. The last small eruption in the caldera occurred about 70,000 years ago. But what exists under that is this. Yeah. You can thank National Geographic for that beautiful picture. So this is what would be the mantle plume. Now, one thing I want to stress, when people think, you know, they see these pictures of plume, and sometimes you think it's magma, but the plume is not magma, it's rock. It's hot rock. And what happens is it only melts at the very upper portion where it impinges on the lithosphere of the Earth, the tectonic plate. So that's where it melts. So once it melts, I mean, this is a huge footprint. You know, look at this compared to the caldera. I mean, it's huge. But when it melts, it then rises up and feeds the magma chambers that exist underneath Yellowstone National Park. So where all this is leading is to this. There's a lot of gloom and doom scenarios today, particularly if you watch things like the History Channel. Wayne knows what I mean here. So the History Channel has a history of doing this. You know, it says there's a certain amount of entertainment value to these kind of natural disaster questions. So, I mean, the big question is, are we going to have another volcanic eruption in Yellowstone? The answer to that is yes. It has to be. You know, you don't just stop 16.5 million years of volcanic activity like that. are we going to have another super eruption at Yellowstone? All indications are that yes, we will have another super eruption at Yellowstone. Again, you have this history of 16.5 million years of super eruption activity. No reason to assume just because we're on Earth that it won't happen in the future. But the bigger question is the next eruption going to be a super eruption? Well, that's something we'd really like to know. And in fact, we have some data that indicates that, well, I'll tell you what it indicates. This is the data. We've imaged underneath Yellowstone National Park a magma chamber about 30 kilometers in diameter. And based on the earthquake data, the seismic data, we realize that that large caldera has within it about 10 to 15% melt. In other words, 10 to 15% magma. So it's very hot rock, and about 10 or 15% of it is liquid rock, magma. But we also believe that it would actually take about 50% melt in order to produce a super eruption. So that's good news. What that means is that the chances of a super eruption occurring in your lifetime or your children's lifetime or your children's children's lifetime is minimal. It's not likely to happen at all. It will happen, but if it happens, it's much more likely to happen thousands, probably even more likely hundreds of thousands of years in the future, the super eruption. But we will continue to have small eruptions at Yellowstone, you know, within the caldera floor. These are not, you know, these are just normal type eruptions. They could be disastrous on a more local scale, but they won't be globally disastrous like a super eruption can be. So just take that with you. Go to the park, enjoy it, and don't worry about eruptions. Thank you. Any questions? Yeah.
Where would the eruption of Santorini fit in with your lecture?
Yeah, Santorini is a good example. It's almost a tweener. You know, it's not quite large enough to have been a super eruption. It would be more akin to Mount Mazama. But there's a caveat to that because it occurs that particular eruption occurred as an island in the Mediterranean. And as it turns out, when water is involved with volcanic eruptions, it becomes much, much more explosive. Krakatoa would probably be the best analogy to go with Santorini. You know, very, very explosive eruption, but not quite up to the standard of a super eruption. Yeah. And then the question becomes, first of all, why is it moving? And second of all, how is it possible to move solid rock through solid rock? I mean, I think that's kind of what you're getting at. So the answer to that is the driving force is the heat, because the heat has lower density. And over geologic time, that lower density, you know, will cause the rock to rise. But it should be impeded by the rock around it. But as it turns out, you're under great lithospheric pressure at those depths. The pressures are so great that rock cannot break. So what it does is it deforms in a plastic fashion. So it actually molds its way up through rock as opposed to breaking rock as it moves up. Now, of course, we've never been there to see that. But that's what we believe happens. Yeah. The plumes have to come from the lower mantle. You know, this is the way it works. Because the heat source has, you know, the only heat source we know that can heat it up and up is the core. You know, so it has to come down at the lower mantle. So as it turns out, there's a boundary in the mantle that kind of separates what we call the upper mantle from the lower mantle. It's called the transition zone. And the upper mantle is where we have all that convective activity. So there's a lot of melting, a lot of motion that exists. And because of all the melting that occurs in the upper mantle, it gets depleted in certain elements, you know, like certain trace elements, you know. So it has a particular signature because it's been melted so many times. But the lower mantle has not been melted, you know, because it doesn't have access to the surface except through mantle plumes. So that means that the rock from the lower mantle, as it moves up through the upper mantle, and this kind of goes back to your question because it tells us that rock has to be from the lower mantle, is that when it melts and erupts at the surface in flood basalt provinces, for example, it has a particular signature of chemistry that indicates that it comes from a lower mantle source. And one of the ones that's a real fingerprint for petrologists that deal with these things are helium isotopes. There's the helium-3 and helium-4 isotopes, and when we look at those ratios, helium-3 that would exist in the mantle, because it's such a light element, it's easily lost, you know, so the concentration of helium-3 in the upper mantle is very low. But in the deep mantle, it's not lost. There's a higher concentration there. So that ratio that we see in the lavas derived from the mantle plumes actually have a ratio that's much more consistent with the lower mantle. So that's one of the chemical signatures. There are others, but that's probably the best chemical signature that we have. Yep. The plume, if you melt the mantle, it's going to produce basalt, always. So what happens is the basalt in the mantle head went right up to the surface in these big fissures that happen. As it turns out, and I didn't explain this, but there happens to be the old boundary of North America, it's called the cratonic boundary of North America, occurs just to the east of where the plume first came up. And on the east side of that boundary is very ancient, old, Precambrian rock. It's very thick, and it's very silicic. To the west of that are much younger accreted terrains that have derived from oceanic islands that have accreted on. So the basement rock is different on two sides. The plume came up the oceanic type crust, and the tail went up the continental crust. But basalt was produced in both cases. But underneath the thick cratonic crust, once the plume came up as basalt, basalt happens to be very high temperature magma. And it turns out that silicic rocks have low melting temperatures. So the high temperature of the basalt actually melted the crust. And when you melt the crust, you produce rhyolite. So then the rhyolite erupted on the surface. But I should also point out, if you go to the Snake River Plain, you see all these rhyolites. But sitting on top of the rhyolites, you also have a little bit of basalt. You know, so there's both. It's called a bimodal province because of that. But the big calderas are associated with the rhyolites. So it's the melting of the crust that produces the rhyolite. Yeah, it's a good question. Yeah. Some people have made the argument that there were bottlenecks in population of different organisms, you know, during that time. And I say bottlenecks as opposed to major mass extinction events. You know, they wouldn't be considered mass extinction events that would destroy 50% or more living things on Earth. But the Siberian flood basalts and the Deccan flood basalts in India are directly contemporaneous with the two major mass extinction events of the Phanerozoic era. One, the greatest one occurring at 254 million years ago, the Permian extinction. That extinction destroyed 95%, actually more than that, of all life on Earth. Only a few percent survived. And that occurred at the same time as the Siberian flood basalt eruption. And the Deccan flood basalts, as I mentioned earlier, they were contemporaneous with the mass extinction that caused the dinosaur extinction period. It's called used to be called the KT extinction. Now it's called the KP or extinction. But that occurred 65 million years ago. And people have actually produced graphs of the ages of flood basalts on one axis and the ages of mass extinction events on the other axis. And there's a perfect linear relationship between the two. You know, I should have showed you that. Actually, it's really, really very impressive. And a lot of people don't talk about that, you know, because a lot of people like the idea of meteorite impacts. And it was clearly there was a meteorite impact 65 million years ago at the same age as the Deccan flood basalts. But both those had to play a role in that mass extinction event. The U.S. Geological Survey, and the USGS has a number of different volcano groups in different places. They have the Cascade Volcano Observatory. They have the Long Valley Caldera Observatory, California, which is another one of these calderas near Mammoth Mountain. And they have the Yellowstone Volcano Observatory, and the people are there specifically to study Yellowstone. And those are the people that have the data, and you know, they're the ones that keep track. So if you want, you have to email them and ask for an app, and you know, that's the way to do it.
Maybe it's on their website.
Maybe it is. Yeah. Well, my opinion of global warming is that all the indications are that it's happening, right? And very few people will argue otherwise. The real argument's kind of morphed a little bit, because it used to be, you know, you have the believers and you have the non-believers, and then the data's just getting too strong. And now the argument becomes, are humans responsible, or are there natural processes that are responsible? And most people attribute it to the burning fossil fuels, and you know, the evidence says it seems to point that way. But there's also an argument that people will make that there are natural causes and natural cycles of cooling and warming in the atmosphere, and that's absolutely true, like glacial conditions, interglacial peaks and global warming and interglacial peaks and then global cooling and the glacial ice age peaks. And that's true also, but the scale is different and the timing is different. For example, if you look at interglacial peaks of global warming, natural cycles of global warming, One way to indicate that is also in CO2 that we can measure the concentration in ice cores. You know, we directly measure that from ancient atmosphere. It's still preserved in those ice cores. And what we find is that when we get to the peak of those glacial periods, 400,000 years of measurements show us that they're very consistently about 280 parts per million of CO2. Very recently on Earth today, we went beyond 400 parts per million, you know, far beyond what we ever had in the peak of those interglacial cycles. And also the rate of increase is much more rapid than what we see in those natural cycles. So, you know, if you look at it really closely, you can break that down. It's not to say that there aren't natural contributions to global warming. There certainly are. But again, if you look at the data in detail, it's not nearly as prevalent as an answer as the burning of fossil fuels and creating greenhouse gases. So, yeah. The most interesting thing about volcanoes to me. I have a lot of mixed feelings about volcanoes, and the reason is because some of my friends have died in studying volcanoes. And I would never suggest that anybody become a volcanologist. It's a very adventurous, exciting thing to do, but it's also one of the most dangerous things you can do. So I restrict my studies to extinct volcanoes. That's probably one of my, you know, they're not quite as exciting as active volcanoes, but they're a lot less dangerous. So. But, you know, all volcanic areas are interesting. I don't know, you know, I can't, there's so many things involved with it. It's a great question. There's so many things involved with it that I'm not sure I can give you a single answer. Anytime you go to a volcanic area, it's also beautifully scenic almost everywhere. So, you know, I like that too. So.
Okay. Thank you. Thank you.